key management is a little bit like air travel. When it works, nobody notices. When it doesn't work, it's really catastrophic. Centralized companies get hacked and people lose access to their data, they lose their money, they lose their assets. The serious nature of doing key management is one of the reasons that we're so principally committed to building this out in a distributed and fault-tolerant way. My name is David Sneider. I'm one of the co-founders of Lit Protocol, a key management network for distributed signing and encryption. We had set up an NFT marketplace and it was fully custodial, Stripe-based marketplace. We just saw that as an opportunity. There was some traffic on it. And one of the prompts and the discussion points that we continue to have is like, okay, collectibles are really cool, but what else can these assets do? And we basically started thinking about NFTs almost as like Web 1 browser windows. And we knew that the evolution of the web was to move from HTML websites to interactive websites with user-generated content. And so we started to think about, what if the metaverse, so to speak, what if the lobby of the metaverse was your crypto wallet and the different assets that you owned were portals or gateways to experiences? Let's test that. Let's figure out how to make NFTs something that can be unlocked. And this was really the kind of the specific prompt that led to the whole notion of Lit, because in the context of thinking about how to make an NFT unlockable, it really came down to a fundamental question, which was, where does the key live that is able to decrypt that content? One fateful day in December of 2020, we're like, well, what if we use a network of nodes to manage this key? And as soon as that idea kind of came to fruition, it was like, oh, wow, this isn't just about NFTs. This is a fundamental primitive that kind of goes back to the core notion of some of the ideas that were put forward in the Bitcoin white paper. What Ethereum and blockchains did for databases in terms of making them distributed, fault-tolerant, and programmable, Lit does the same thing for key management systems. Fundamentally, Lit protocol is an answer to a question, which is, can the internet keep a secret? When building in key management, the primary goal is safety. And so in order to prioritize the safety and the security of these keys, that affects the entire breadth of the project, from the architecture in the context of using distributed keys and then having the extra layer of encrypted virtualization, to the node operator selection process, to the update process. Basically, how do we step up the security from what's available today? The general paradigm of what's available today is that there are single companies that are either responsible for managing an entire key, or they are reliant parties where these companies can censor or deny somebody access to their funds. And for myself and my teammates, this is an untenable solution if we're intending to build a world where people have agency over their funds, over their data, as we move into this whole world of digital ownership. The journey to founding this project, if I spin it way back, probably started when I was a teenager and got interested in astronomy. And this is pre-Reddit, and found out there was this website called Hacker News where there was a bunch of really interesting and thoughtful discussions on a lot of topics, with the main focus on technological developments and the startup culture and startup mindset. Came across Kurzweil's book, The Singularity is Near, conceptualized the notion of the accelerating rate of technological change, and basically at that point made the decision that the story of technology would be the story of impact in my lifetime. I was always interested in startups from a young age. When I was in high school, I had purchased a couple of soda machines. As soon as I was able to drive, servicing those soda machines was my job. In 2013, started a B2B SaaS business with a couple friends. We grew that over the course of a couple years. That business was acquired by LinkedIn in 2017. But in the Bay Area, in that time period, was familiarized with Bitcoin, exposed to the Ethereum white paper, and upon reading that and understanding it, was basically ignited with the idea, and am still today more than ever, that distributed systems and programmable money hold enormous potential for building the next iteration of the web. And in our digitally mediated society, the interaction on the web is the foundation for the interaction for everything. Coming across the Ethereum white paper a few years later, it was like, this is the thing. This is the infrastructure that enables society and technology to level up in a way where the fundamental notion of who's in control is readdressed in a very deep way. One of the big lessons that I took away from working in the SaaS space for 4 years is to be able to delineate between activity and progress. It's very easy to generate a lot of activity, and it's very easy to track metrics around activity, but activity by itself is actually not that useful. The real important thing to focus on is progress. What does our customer need? Are we moving closer to providing that need? Are we articulating, providing our benefits clearly? And being able to have a clear delineation between activity and progress, I think will dramatically increase the chances of success for anybody that's working on early stage technology. When communicating to folks about what you make, the best way to communicate that is through the lens of what can you do for them rather than what is your system. Do discovery, go talk to the people who are doing the thing, doing the processes involved in building or creating in the situation where you're hoping to provide some solution. One of the most exciting things about the current epoch of Web3 that we're in right now at the end of 2023 is the lens of experimentation. In gaming, for example, we're starting to see more and more fully on-chain games. What's really interesting there is you can imagine LLMs, AI models, and Lit together to basically power autonomous economic agents. An NPC or a non-player character involved in an on-chain game that you can transact with. Things that start out looking like toys actually end up being really significant technological, epoch-defining technology. The notion of the music box is basically the predecessor to all of programming. And this is a trend that has emerged over and over and over again. What's next for me is what's been happening the past 3 years, which is to continue to work on building Web3, work on building distributed key management, to get back to the fundamental ideas of the early stages of the internet before it was co-opted by the walled gardens and Web2 platforms. There's an arc of maturity, and the internet is on an arc of maturity as well. And for me, it's quite obvious that what's happening in Web3, the type of work that we're doing around distributed keys at Lit, is a part of that process as we move to a more mature internet, judged by how much agency individuals have when they're interacting with these systems. As part of the development team behind Lit, it's been really lovely to work with the folks at Protocol Labs. There's the whole notion of the ideals that I certainly agree with that Protocol Labs puts forward. And then there's the fundamental ways in which these systems can work together. For example, many teams store encrypted data that has been encrypted with Lit, and the place where that data gets stored is on IPFS or Filecoin. We'll see what happens, but with the right incentives and the right governance, the fundamental primitives and the new infrastructure that is being created today, the best case scenario is that these fundamental technologies last for thousands and thousands of years into the future.